Hi everyone, my name's Ski Oakenfull. Welcome to Friday Forum Live, Point Blank's weekly broadcast, bringing you exclusive tutorials, artist interviews and industry insight every Friday live from East London. Today we're breaking apart Disclosure's huge hit Latch and showing you how it was made in Ableton Live. So, today we're going to take a closer look at the beat, chords and sounds of Latch in Ableton Live. If you want to master Ableton, our online diploma course is perfect for you. You can find out more on our website at pointblanklondon.com. And remember, we are live, so if you've got any questions about the tutorial or Point Blank in general, stick them in the comments and I'll get to them at the end of the broadcast. So, Latch by Disclosure, what a tune. Obviously, so many brilliant aspects to the track. I mean, apart from anything, just the wonderful vocal by Sam Smith. I think originally it started out as an instrumental by the guys, but I think, yeah, we'll start off just talking about the beat because this is like one of the most distinctive things about the track. And the thing about it is it's actually got a triplet feel. So I'll just quickly talk about that. Most modern pop music, dance music, so much music is written in 4-4 time. So that basically means four beats in a bar. So we can count that, go 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now if I clap twice on every beat, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. These are called quavers. 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. If I clap three times in every beat, they're called triplets. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So for some of you that may be kind of like quite basic stuff, but this is what makes this track really distinctive. And to be honest, there are not that many pop or dance tracks with that kind of feel. I've got a couple of examples here, some pop tracks. I'm going to play those to you now. And if, you know, during a broadcast you can think of any others, then please put them in the comments section. But here's a classic by Billy Ocean. You might know this one. So you can count 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. There we go. And then another classic. 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Amazing track, takes me back. Okay, so back to Latch. Tracking question. If we look, I'm using push here and Ableton Live as you can see, and I've got some drum sounds here. These are the sounds I'm going to be using for the beat. Just quickly, I can kind of demonstrate that as well using push, so using the repeat function. So if I just turn on the metronome, just want to say something about the new Ableton 9.2 update. I've got the beta here. And one of the brilliant things now is when you turn on the metronome and a couple of other functions as well, it starts flashing, which is brilliant because it kind of helps you see what if it's on or not. But anyway, if I've got repeat on here. There we go. So I'm just holding down the hi-hat at the moment. 1, 2, 3, 4. And I've got the setting here as 1/4. So these are the crotchets I was talking about. If I put it to 1/8, these are the quavers, and the next one up is 1/8 T. T stands for triplet. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And this is the feel of this Latch track. So while I'm putting this, or programming the stuff in this track, I'm going to put quantize on, and I've just taken a picture of it actually, so you can see what it looks like on push. Here we go. 1/T, record quantize on. So I'm just going to press quantize here and make sure that's on. So let's just get rid of that and let's just put in the beat. I'll talk a little bit afterwards about the sounds and the way that I created this drum rack as well. So let's just start off. There we go. So let's put in the hi-hat now. I think, yeah, you can see that on there. That's okay. Now we've got a couple of sort of sound effects as well that I've sort of recreated, so let's put those in. Oh, a little double hit there, but I think that came at the right place. Cool, now there was also, what I noticed there was this kind of scratchy effect. It sounded almost like kind of vinyl, but I think it was programmed. So I've got this kind of little clicky sound here that I'm going to put into the beat. And I'm gonna use the repeat function on push for this. And I'm gonna use the fastest one that there is, which is 1/32 triplets. I'll just play that. Yeah, it's really fast. And I'm gonna take the accent off so that I can kind of crescendo it up. So I'll play you what it's gonna sound like. Put it in. There we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. You can hear the triplet feel. There we go. So that's the first version of the beat. And there's another version which I'm going to program now, actually, which comes for the chorus. And the only difference with that is just the hi-hat. The closed hi-hat. So I'm just going to get rid of, on this one, I'm just going to get rid of the closed hat that I put in. There we go, let's just delete it on there. And again, I'm going to use the repeat function. I'm going to put it on 1/8 T. There we go, and yeah, the accent is off. So let's record this in. There we go. And if I now put the 1/16 T on triplet, we can just fill in those gaps at the end. There we go. So we've got our two beats there. Just have a quick look at the drum rack. So yeah, these are the sounds. I just kind of, let's just take the repeat off. There we go. These are sounds that I kind of they were either in the Ableton library. You can see there's this clap here is the 808 clap. I also kind of made a couple of the sounds. There's this one here, which let me just bring that up. There we go. Where is it? There we go. That's actually like a cowbell sound from Operator. And then this one here is an analog. This is a sound that I created. And also, I put reverb on some of the sounds, like the clap, and I put a reverb as a return within the drum rack, and I've got some sidechain compression on that reverb, and as the sidechain, I'm actually taking the drum channel. So you can see that there. If I try and zoom in, there we go. And then right at the end of the whole chain, I've got a glue compressor on everything, which kind of pulls it together. Let's just take that off. It works especially well with the reverb. It really kind of gels it all together. So there we go. Let's talk now about the key signature and the chords. Now these chords are just amazing, I think. I mean, they're just so kind of emotional and really jazzy as well. And I did a little bit of fishing around on YouTube and I found a couple of tutorials. And it just seemed to me that the chords were oversimplified, basically. They weren't even right, to be honest. And so I kind of really had to go in myself and do some research and just try to sort of figure out really just by ear, what was going on. So that's what I've done. To help me, I actually managed to get the a cappella. It's kind of readily available. I think I found it on SoundCloud. So yeah, I mean, you can look for that if you need it. So yeah, let's talk about the key signature to start off with. So I'm just gonna bring up the keyboard here, and I've also got something I've written down here. Now, I identified, let's put this onto the Rode sound, there we go. Now, I identified the key signature as F minor. which has got four flats. But the interesting thing is that the first chord is actually a B flat minor. It's actually a B flat minor 7. So let me just play the vocal, and you can kind of hear, because you could think that it was actually in B flat. And when we talk about key signature, we're talking about the tonic, the tonal center. So, actually, what I'll do first is I'll just play the kind of simplified version of the chord. So, first of all, we have B flat minor 7, then an F minor 7, then this chord here, which is like an A flat major 7, but I'm just playing a different inversion, and then this one here, which is like an F sharp major 7 over B. So you can see that this first chord is actually a B flat. So let's just play this again. So it's interesting. So you could think the tonal center was this B flat. But I'm thinking it's the tonal center is actually F, which makes it F minor. So if I just kind of play around some chords in F minor.
You enchant me even when you're not around. If there are boundaries, I will try to knock them down.
So it sounds a bit more bluesy, but I'm feeling it's F minor. So I'm going to go with the F minor version here. Maybe in the comment section, someone might want to disagree with me, but this is what I'm going to go for. So let's look at the chords now, and we're going to start off on. Actually, before we do that, we should just put in the. There's a really simple arpeggio pattern that happens at the start, which is this. I'm going to go into programming this sound at the end as well. But let's just program this in. Here we go. Okay, and let's just have the drums in here as well. There we go. Here we go, so. There we go. Still got the quantize on, so that's still putting it on the 1/8 T. So let's copy these down. And let's put in the pad chords. Now these chords are kind of, this is what I've worked out. They're quite complex. I'm just gonna play them to you very slowly here now. And the first one is like a B flat minor 7 with this A flat here. Then in left hand, I'm playing an F minor. And then we've got this, it's like a kind of D flat sus 2, but instead of the top note being an A flat, I'm playing a B flat. There we go. Then we've got a B flat minor there with these two notes here, and then this chord here. And then the last time, for the last time round, this chord, this fourth chord, goes up here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to slow the tempo right down so to help me put them in, and also so you can actually follow what's going on. You can see I've warped the vocal, so it makes it much easier to do. Okay, so here we go. Let's put these chords in, or attempt to anyway. Here we go, the juicy chord here. There we go. Let's just speed it up. You can see also I've got a sidechain set up here, which I've got on the pad. Let's just show you that quickly. There you can hear that. So on that sidechain channel, it's just a 909 kit. I've just got the kick drum there as the sidechain input. And you can see it working there. Obviously, it's a very kind of overused effect now, but it's used very effectively on this track. Okay, so this is the kind of, that's the verse section. Now we're going to get into the breakdown section. And for this, the drums drop out and we have those same chords. But we have the arpeggio pattern. So I'm going to slow the tempo right down for this as well. And just go on to the arpeggio. Here we go. And again, I kind of had to figure this out. And I actually kind of transcribed it. Here we go. So for all you kind of people that can read music, I'm hoping you can see that. I'll play it to you. It's so that's the part. Let's see if I can actually play it in. Here we go, slow it down even more. So here we go. I might make a few mistakes, but I can always fix them if I do. So here we go. Hold on one sec. Let's just stop this. There we go. Let's try and put these back for you. Here we go. All right. And keeps disappearing. Okay. There we go, we're back. All right, so let's give it a go. let's give it another go. We're gonna get there, I'm sure. Okay, here we go. Yes, we made it. There we go. And take the metronome off now. Now, there's also, at this point, there's also another texture to these chords, which is another pad sound. Let's just put this in. In fact, before I do that, I should just bring up the keyboard just so you can see what's going on. Here we go. There we go, here it is. There we go, so let's just put this in. Got a B flat there. F, D flat, E flat. And there's some chords. These are just slight variations on top that go over that. There we go. What we can do now is just speed it back up again. Just that second chord's a bit delayed, so I'm just going to put that back. There we go. So for the next section, which is this, I'm calling this pre-chorus, I'm going to copy those parts over and then the drums come back in. There we go. Then we have the chorus section. And at this point, this new beat that I programmed earlier comes in. And the bass drops. So the bass is very interesting because, in fact, let me just go onto here. Oops, find a bass. Here we go. There's the bass. I'm just going to bring up the keyboard again. And for this section, the bass line is this. So So you can see the first movement of the first two chords is keeping the same with this B flat and the F, but then we go up to an E flat and a C and a D flat there. So I've actually prepared this bass line earlier in the classic kind of Blue Peter fashion. There we go, let's just bring up the Blue Peter badge. There we go. Hope you can all see that. It's orange actually, very appropriately point blank. So yeah, I've prepared this earlier. Let's put this in because it's quite a tricky bass line to play, to be honest. So let me just play that to you now. There we go. There we go, that's the part. So, and then for the second part of that chorus, we can just copy all these parts down. There we go. There we go, and the bass. Basically all the chords and pads in the arpeggio come back in. And then using push, we can go from section to section. So these are the kind of key elements. Things to notice, which I haven't kind of programmed for the time being, is there's generally like drops, like a bar drop just going into the next section with kind of like white noise sweeps, so those kind of things. But I'm just going to talk about a couple of the sounds that I use, the arpeggio and the pad, and just go through how I created those. So let's just start off with the arpeggio sound. And if I just put on to here, there we go, can play it here. So this was created using analog, and what I'm going to do is just show you how I built that up from scratch. So I'm just going to create a new track there, MIDI track, and let's go to, let's drag over an analog. There we go. Okay, so this is kind of raw sound, this is the default sound. start off just with the routing. I'm just going to go for this bottom left here. Let's just zoom in actually so you can see what I'm doing a bit more clearly. Okay, so this is the filter and amplitude routing I've got here. Now a key part of this sound is the fact it's a square wave, so just changing this. I'm just going to turn off oscillator 2 for the moment, so we're only working with oscillator 1. Okay, and we're going to take the width of this to 100%. You can see that makes a big difference. With this, it's a really kind of thin, gritty sound. As we bring it out, just makes it kind of more square wave like. So there we go, so that's that. And then we're going to go over to the frequency. So let's just take this down for the moment. Let's put, take it down to around, I don't know, around 50, there we go. And then take the resonance up. Take this to, I don't know, around 46, 47. And then just keep the attack as it is. The decay, take this down to around 260. There we go. Sustain, take that down as well. We want it to be quite a kind of sharp sound. And then the release, take this down as well. Around, I don't know, around 60 is probably fine. There we go. Then we're going to go to the LFO. And let's just turn the LFO on. And yeah, let's put it so it's actually syncing. We can keep that so it's syncing to the crotchet beats there. And then go back to here. And yeah, let's just increase the LFO. That basically means the LFO is going to be affecting the filter cutoff. You can hear it there. But let's just take it down a bit to, yeah. I'll go, quickly go back actually, and we'll put sync on, or sorry, retrig on, so that every time it's starting at the same point in the LFO wave. Just the key a little bit, that sort of determines the envelope or the filter cutoff as like the, where you are on the keyboard. And yeah, the envelope's pretty good up there. Let's just increase it a little bit. There we go. And then just look at the amplitude section. Let's just turn it up a little bit. There we go. And just increase the attack a little bit. Not too much, but I just think a little bit. There, so it's just a little bit smoother, that attack. Take it down, there we go. decay, take that right down. So it's kind of quite sharp. Sustain, take that right to the top, and the release, about 120 milliseconds, I think. And I don't want any velocity sensitivity, so I'm just taking the velocity to envelope down. Might really need to compensate there just by turning the level up. We've already done the LFO. Just quickly go to the oscillator 2. We're going to change that to square wave as well. And if we just detune it slightly, just going to give a bit of a kind, it just sort of fattens the sound, gives a slight sort of chorusing effect. And yeah, let's make it mono as well. And there's our sound. And all we need to do is just, well, you can put any effect on it you want, obviously, but I'm just putting a bit of reverb on. So that's how to create the sound. You can kind of obviously vary the filter cutoff, but that's a great sound. And then the pad, I sort of cheated a bit really with this. I used one of the Ableton presets, which is called Weeping Strings. It's a sort of firm favourite of mine, and one of the reasons I love it is it's got these macros set up to basically affect the cutoff. So, you know, you can use it as a great kind of high string sound, but then when you take the cutoff down, it's just a beautiful kind of pad sound. And I'll actually kind of use that in this. If we have this section here, see, it's working really well. So there you go. One of the things that I didn't mention was that we're going to make this project available to download. So just check the description after we finished, and you'll see all the details of how to download the project. And if there's stuff that you kind of missed about the chords, or just you want to analyze them a bit deeper, then please download the project and you can check it out. We're out of time for today's FFL. Hopefully you got plenty of inspiration for the weekend, and if you're thirsty for more, we've got Ableton Live courses to suit all skill levels. Find out more on our website, pointblanklondon.com, and we'll be back next week for another Friday Forum Live. Cheers, see you later.